Welcome, Amita and Kalyani Menon Sen. The reason why we thought of putting this session together at Dodin is actually a comment that Kalyani, you made a couple of weeks ago in some conversation with me, where you said that you haven't, you don't really recall hearing the word care in a university setting. And that got me thinking, because one would imagine that university spaces are actually all about, or should be all about, caring. But caring in a very, very rich sense, in the sense of the work that it involves in terms of the obligations that we have to each other. And to me and to several of my friends who sometimes teach occasionally, sometimes teach full-time, the past 8 months have really been a big struggle to figure out what we are doing. The struggle, Amita, was really that you have students who are in situations that we don't fully understand, or we have only an inkling of. It is about the timing, it is about the place, it is about the stresses that we that are not visible to us. And then we are ourselves actually sitting at home trying to deal with the concerns of how to care for ourselves and for others. So in some ways, you know, everything collapsed all around us. And it was not easy to find our way through this. So the question that I would actually be really interested in hearing from both of you some kind of response to is, where have we come from? I mean, does this pandemic and lockdown reveal something that is a fundamentally and very deep-rooted manner already an issue in our education system? Or is this something which has happened conjuncturally at this point of time and it will go away, you know, once the lockdown is over and students are back in colleges, you know, can we return to the normal life? What is going on? So in that sense, both from your practice point of view as teachers, as researchers, as feminists, and with an eye on the institutional framework structures, if you can give us some sense of where we are at this point of time and what does this moment hold for us in terms of directions for the future, that will be really, really a worthwhile conversation for all of us to have at this point of time. So over to you.
Amita, you want to go first?
Okay, I can perhaps as a member of the university community. And I want to actually start by thanking you, Kalyani, for provoking Anand to think about this and for Anand to actually formulate the session on this kind of a very engaging question, I would say. Because it is not just provocative, but it is something which is, I think, that one has to think deeply about and be reflective about. You know? And it's like the minute you start scratching below the surface, there are so many things which you have been living with and which just kind of start exposing oneself. I found this question of Anand in terms of how did we get to where we are, I think, particularly engaging. Because I don't think, yes, in some ways, the pandemic has created multiple challenges before us, but I think it is not all about the pandemic. I think over the years, and now I am in this teaching profession from the last from 1994 to currently, which means roughly more than 20, 25 years. And the more I think about the university as a setup, I want to bring about two, three things and about the changes that one has been witnessing and experiencing. So the first is, I think, even within universities and particularly Indian universities, I think teaching was the core of the university. And therefore, if one looks at the entire action, if the university is an action system, it was all focused around that teaching, you know, and the contact with students was the maximum. But over the years, what I see is teaching has been reduced to more and more a functional activity. There are many more parameters of that role which have been starting to get emphasized more and more. So it is not as if the research or publications was not part of the university system. But I think these as parameters of performance of teachers and measuring their role within the university, I think this has started increasing tremendously. And I think the way it impacts teachers is something which is, I think, yes, because that's how teachers then begin to internalize what is important, what is not important. So that's one setup. I think the second is a push, the overall way in which universities are located as part of the larger educational system in India. And I see two fault lines within that. So number one, I think
that's one.
I think we took too many support systems for that, for granted. And these included the governmental scholarships, which have been pretty generously pitched in the past. We took for granted other philanthropic support to the universities, which made up for the shortfalls in this governmental scholarship system and governmental support system. And thirdly, because teachers and that teaching activity was supreme, one could also leverage multiple connections and networks. And so I'm not just talking of the financial aid, but it is also reaching out in other ways. And that is how universities started developing systems like informal counseling, buddy systems, and then counseling and appointing professional counselors, including a warden's role, which was not just an admin role, but it was supposed to be also having tremendous elements of caring. And my memories, even as a university student, are full of fun with the wardens. You know, it's not just the warden in terms of giving memos and things like that. I think all of these support systems have become more and more fragmented, is what I see. Linked to that is the third function of the question being asked about what is the actual role of the university. So it is not just about teachers and the effectivity or the parameters by which teachers are measured, but what is the university's role in society? What is the university's role and whether caring is even part of that entire function. Okay? And I think I think that question increasingly becomes important as all of these systems get unraveled. The second fault line, I think, which I see developing over the years is that we've given it too fast, I think, to the overall group and category-based systems of the governmental aid. And I think these are very important, but at the same time, that there is no existence beyond categories is also something which increasingly in the outside atmosphere, which is stressed because so many other reasons, students wanting to be independent, parental pressure on them on what kind of career goals to set up, family structures themselves undergoing change of a whole lot. And therefore, students also in some ways revolting against all of that. At a master's level, at a postgraduate level, all the pressures of being placed somewhere and suddenly being settled in life. I think there are multiple things, I think, which have been unraveling bit by bit, part by part. I think the stresses of this were already showing in the system. I think we experienced that with Rohit Vemula earlier. We experienced that with other cases of not just student suicides, but also student protests and the ways in which students also drop out, I think. And this is where I think we have come to where we are. Our assumptions then of digital India, the outreach, the kind of help, I think the pandemic just escalated all of these issues. But I think I'll come to those issues perhaps a little later. But I think a lot of these issues, we were heading for this. And the university as an institution, the people within. So it has finally come down from a systemic caring, I think it is left to now individual teachers or individual centers to where the closest contact with students is to become the fulcrum of whatever caring is possible. And that poses a whole lot of limitations as well.
Thank you, Amita.
You know, yeah, Amita, that's, I feel so good hearing that. I mean, to hear you speak of the university in terms of an institutional system, because my natural habitat is not the university. I work with learning, but learning as a vehicle to transform institutional institutions and their systems. And basically, the larger focus of my work is creating institutions that are spaces of peace, justice, equality, not just gender equality, but equality is general. And actually, I completely agree with you, Amita. This fault line has been there since the inception of the university system, and probably even more. It's culturally a very, very sort of concrete, embedded kind of fault line. And this kind of separation between the private sphere of the life of the individual and the institutional sphere where the individual is seen as one component in a system, this is something that feminist pedagogy has always challenged. So that big shift when feminist teachers entered university spaces and started working. I mean, if you look at it, everything was challenging this division. Mm-hmm. And I kind of feel that this COVID moment, as I was telling Anand the other day, it's full of possibilities, because all of a sudden it's made it visible to everybody, mm-hmm. even the most battle-hardened patriarchal thinkers, whether men or women, have been forced to acknowledge that this separation is a very artificial one. Mm-hmm. So it's actually the fact that COVID has affected people and has kind of forced people to confront their own mortality, to confront their own helplessness in the face of the state or in the disease. It's like issues like Rohit Vemula being forcibly thrown out from his hostel room because he couldn't pay the fees in time, and many, many other students in JNU, for instance, which people said, these people are just sitting there eating sarkari money, and if you can't pay your fees, you have to be thrown out, and ye koi ghar hai tumhara, used to be a constant, you know, refrain. Today, when the children of those people also are being thrown out of hostels in universities and being forced to go back to homes where there is neither spatial safety nor the kind of intellectual safety that allows students to pursue their academic endeavors, they're realizing that this notion that there is an impermeable wall between one's life and between the institution, the educational institution, this is a completely constructed notion. It's total rubbish. Yeah. And the point is that the individual doesn't cease to be an individual simply because they've entered a system, nor does the system remain insulated from that whole economy of, you know, care, what we in our feminist analyses call the care economy, which is not a transactional economy, which is not a monetized economy, and which involves continuous, spontaneous, willingly given work of care. It is labor, but it is labor that is very embodied, and where the emotional component and the physical component are continuously regenerating the circumstances of life. Without that care economy, no institution, least of all a university, could function. So all of these stories of the sacrifices that people have made, families have made, to send their children to public universities, which are completely invisibilized in that space. I mean, my position and the position of all of us as feminist educators is that invisibilizing this whole backstory, this whole invisible foundation of care that sustains the monetized transactional educational institution, invisibilizing it is a big mistake. The alienation that you are seeing of teachers like yourself from that university system, the alienation of students from that transactional model of education, the alienation of society and social justice from the academic sphere, all of it is rooted in this primary patriarchal binary between the world of care and love and personal relationships and the world of, you know, disembodied systemic relationships. Literally a notion of education that is disembodied from life and existence and from the personal subjectivity, the personal identities of the people who are engaged in it. So I'm really seeing this as a moment of possibility. And I like Amita, like Shirley, Anant, and everybody else in this room, is hoping that we never return to a situation where it's like, let's go back to life as normal. Let's forget everything that's happened. Let's forget the students who've lost their lives, lost their educations, lost their chances of meeting their aspirations. Let's forget all that and go back to a university. And I'm speaking from my experience. My granddaughter is a student in JNU. She was in the hostel in JNU. The hostel students in certain hostels have been pleading for years for a comprehensive some kind of intervention that gets rid of the bed bug infestation in all the hostels. And the university has been saying, no, we can't shut down the hostels just to kill the bed bugs. So my granddaughter and her friends in the hostels are now saying, you are willing to shut down the hostels to kill the students and to kill the possibility of their ever coming back into the educational stream. That is not a problem, but when it's the students saying, care for us, give us at least pest-free rooms to stay in, that's, you know, ye aapka ghar nahi hai. Itne aaram se aap reh nahi sakte. Yahan aap padhne aaye ho, takleef uthani padegi agar padhni chahiye. You know, it's like crude, callous statements which completely act as if the student is just a brain who is popped into the classroom and has nothing that student's body, life, family, personal problems and pressures have nothing to do. Tumhe yahan padhna hai aur exam pass karna hai. Zinda raho ya na raho, wo hamari baat nahi hai. So now that day to hear Anant and his colleagues in AUD talking about when you connect with a student online, it's not just intuiting that there are problems at home. It's not just intuiting that this person is coming to the learning space with a whole ongoing history of struggle. It's actually seeing it. And once you see it, it's not just sensitive teachers, it's even teachers who have managed to keep the curtain closed on that side of life, who are forced to acknowledge that you can't talk about, you know, postmodern analysis of something or the other. When you can see a household, you can see a household struggling in the middle of deprivation, in the middle of health challenges, in the middle of enormous emotional pressures. You are forced to acknowledge that teaching and learning are activities that demand the whole person, the whole life and the whole person of the teacher as much as the whole life and the whole person of the student. So I'm seeing this as a moment when people like us can really push for a radically changed, caring practice of teaching and learning within the academic space.
Anant, can I come in? Or is there a question that you want to ask?
No. You can come in. After that, I want to open it to the there are a lot of people who are very excited and interested in this conversation.
Okay.
No, and it's really, really very important for us to do this. Yes.
No, I like really, and I wish I could wholeheartedly embrace Kalyani's optimism about this being a moment of possibility. No, I really wish and I really hope that it happens as such. But the way I'm reading institutions, the way I'm reading things around me, Kalyani, I don't see that possibility actually emerging around me. Rather, see, so I'll just give you two experiences here. So this is like anecdotal really, but coming from my own experience. So one is the classes that I have had online with our second years. Okay? So we have known these students over the first years, and being smaller batches, we know almost every one of them with a lot of the barriers that they face and also the strengths that they have. We a little bit insight, I would say, and some effort. On the other hand, we've gone about, and the first year batch is almost completely invisible to us. Okay? So much so that a common thing for teachers is to begin to associate a name with a face. Okay? We don't even know. So I am a faceless being to the students. The students are faceless beings to me. Okay? Attendance becomes a... because I think even that meaningless thing called attendance is also important way in which you begin this recognition of face to name, then to personalities and so on and so forth. It's like the grammar of the class, you know, how it starts, absolutely, right? But none of these, because that is also technicized, right? When you do a Zoom thing, it's programmed to take attendance. So the leverages that teachers have in order to also understand students, chalo, theek hai, this ye banda jo hai, wo 10 minute late aata hai, accept. So there is no scope for any of that. Okay? So this is one thing where I think the system completely invisibilizes this. This, as a dean of the School of Habitat Studies in TISS, my experiences, we have had a rather unusual number of students who are dropping out. Okay? But even this does not get recognized at an institutional level that this is an issue. Okay? We made large claims in terms of all those who will have issues in terms of accessing mobiles or smartphones or laptops, the institute will reach out laptops to them. Okay? We did try. Okay? And we did try to reach out. You know, we acquired something like 100 plus laptops and something. Okay? But all the courier companies were closed. So I think those efforts and those accessibilities have been provided only to a few students. Plus there are, I think, other digital connectivity issues, no? Recharge ke liye paisa nahi hai. Recharge terms have been changed by mobile companies. Yeah, okay. So other systems, definitely they are taking advantage. But for the university, most importantly, the stance is we have done everything that we can. Okay? And the teaching activity has to move on irrespective of. Okay? Yeah. And irrespective of is a very big irrespective of. Yeah. So students are also one part of it, which just gets swept. Okay?
Absolutely.
You mop up as many revenues as you can. Yeah. You become more and more self-sufficient. Okay, because most institutions and colleges today, I also see, are reeling under governments not paying and releasing grants and all of that. Okay? So, I just think the students are becoming invisible. Yeah. Like one comment I remember at the end of one of the courses that I did last semester, okay, and I'm really touched by that comment. A student gave me a feedback, ma'am, your voice is one of the warmest voices that I've ever heard. Okay? Now, I always saw teaching as also one part of it being a performative kind of dimension to it. But I never realized this kind of importance that voice could have. Okay? One has not consciously used it. Okay? Or one has not worked upon one's personality as a teacher and personhood as a tool or as an instrument of reaching out. Okay? But I think these are things from which students are latching on. Exactly. I mean, that's what I see.
Exactly.
In the want of everything else, right? And there is also that sense of helplessness ki a student is absent like for a whole number of days. Okay? Lost because there is somebody in the family who is ill. The actual carer, the student's mother, is stuck somewhere in a foreign country. Okay? And so the student takes on the responsibility of being the sole caretaker for a father who is ailing. Okay? And as a result of which, she is missing classes. Okay? Now, how does one reach out to her? What are the instruments? I mean, it brings about and makes one, I mean, when it is reduced to a single teacher who takes on the onus of caring, I think it's more and more creating a sense of helplessness and realizing really the limits of that individuated burden of care.
Exactly.
And I think really, therefore, I do hope somewhere that institutions begin to realize we are not stitching together things. We are actually so fragmented in our overall response. We may talk the language of being student-centered, but actually we are not student-centered, or rather the student is the role, you know, that one is kind of developed in a particular way. All other dimensions of that life of the person who also is a student are actually cut.
Exactly.
So I wish we could, but I'm not seeing those signs.
We are totally on the same page on this, Amita. I'm not proposing online learning as an alternative. Yeah. I'm saying this moment of online learning, I hope, is some kind of epiphany for key actors in the institution. What you're saying, I'm just linking it back with what you started by saying, so that in university system has become so transactional and teacher-centered and teaching-centered. So regardless of whether anybody is learning or not, the teaching must go on. Regardless of whether anybody is engaging or not, the exam must go on. So I'm saying this is a moment where some forced questioning of that understanding of the system of education is bubbling. And that questioning is coming not just from people like us who have always been questioning it, but from many people who pretty callous on these accounts. So I'm saying, can we somehow expand that into a real rupture so that we don't come back to the world as before, to the system as before? This recognition that the system is broken and that this divide, divide that has created the transaction, that has created the alienation, it was always there and it's now split so far apart that lipapoti karke papering it over should not be possible anymore. I am feeling optimistic about this, Amita, because when that really all-out frontal attack was going on against JNU, that 3 months when the teachers were conducting classes in public and saying that the teaching learning activity is not dependent on the bricks and walls and tables and chairs. It is you and us as people in the same space. It actually broke all these disciplinary boundaries. And for the first time, people from the science schools were attending social science lectures and vice versa. You know, all of these boundaries and separations are actually artificial. So we've made it into a transaction where you follow one track and don't see the connections. That was a moment when these ruptures were ripe for us to get in there and plant something. But then the kind of violence with which that was crushed, and then rapidly following on it, the whole CAA movement and then COVID, somehow we just couldn't. None of us who are engaged in, transforming, dreaming of transforming the education system, we couldn't we couldn't claim the space created at that moment. And I'm saying now that those cracks have become crevasses, they've become gulfs. I dare any university to try and paper over it. I dare any university to pretend that 100% of their students had access. And I think we should really make that contradiction and that huge implosion visible to everybody.
Kalyani, if I'm hearing you right, what you seem to be saying is that this is not a moment of reforming the institution anymore, because the hoax that the institution can be, the anachronism of the institution, it has all become too apparent now, too open for it to be put back together in the same form.
Precisely.
And that would mean then that we can't really imagine our answers from within the old logics. We need to think them in another framework, right?
Exactly.
And you know, my own experience, and I'm sure this has been the experience with a lot of teachers, is that one of the things that we had to really depend on in being able to run some kind of a learning program was to really depend on the students themselves and the energies that they bring to the classroom, their anxieties, their energies, their aspirations. That was what was actually making teaching even viable. And I think that was a very, very significant shift, even though we knew that that teaching can be student-centric, that it should be student-centric and so on. What it really means is something that hit us in the face only now. And I think that's a very important thing to take into account. And the other thing that I think was very important is that other than reaching out for support systems and logics and infrastructures and so on from within the university system, we were actually reaching out to other teachers, we were reaching out to other people all over the place a lot more. And I think that was a very, very important shift that has already happened. So the question then for me would be that part of what we need to do, at least, in, you know, even as we have to continue to inhabit those old institutional spaces, because we can't leave them, because those are convening spaces that bring together some people. Even as we do that, the thing that we need to think about is how do we seize this moment and figure out what kinds of new networks can be created for support and solidarity, for the new imaginations for teaching.
Exactly. I mean, Anant, if you and Amita agree, I think we should ask the others in the room to speak. But I just want to say one thing. This, I'm just tying it back in. It is a question. The shift is really from the university as a transactional space and education as a transactional process to the university as a relational space and education as a relational process. And that's a profound kind of blow against patriarchy. I see it clearly. I think the feminist lens shows it clearly. So that may be a reason, but I think everybody is seeing it now.
Great.
Yeah.
So I want to open this up for people in the room. Isha, Gautam, Mukta, Tashi, do you want to jump in? Any of you, please. We have another 10 minutes to quickly wrap this up, but I promise you this is not the last of these conversations. This is just the beginning, and I'm really, really hoping that we will be able to build something.
I mean, I'm feeling so privileged to be able to talk to Amita, to be able to talk to you.
Same here, Kalyani.
Really? Are you all students? Is everybody else in the room a student, other than the three oldies?
No. There are three students, and I think the others are not students. Gautam, are you here?
I am here. But honestly, I was just so happy to listen today. I think, you know, these are issues that are so, I totally agree with Kalyani. I don't know, I'm hoping that more and more people are seeing it. But I think for those of us in the classrooms, we felt it so acutely. And the language she was using about this separation between, you know, the individual and their wholeness that comes into the system, I think it has helped me see what I was struggling with teaching. No thoughts from me. I mean, this has really been weighing on my mind for a while, and it was just very good to hear both Amita and Kalyani articulate it in ways that have given me some language to begin to untangle the mess in my head. So just thanks a lot to both of you.
Is that Gautam Bhan?
Yes, Kalyani. Hi.
But I also just got a message from someone just telling me that those in the room are not the only audience. We are on Facebook, and there are a lot of students who are listening in on this, even though they're not speaking up yet.
Now, I think it would be nice to hear from students on what it feels like to be a cog in a transactional system of education, and how different it feels.
Vanshika, do you want to jump in on that?
I actually wanted to go back to two moments in this year. One is while Dr. Amita Bhire told us that, you know, this is a year about seeing fractures in the digital media and the access that it provides, one saw that the administration is nevertheless more and more just enforcing more faith into that medium. So we saw a national testing agency going on about its tests. We saw a case in the High Court about exams in the University of Delhi, where while earlier, as Dr. Kalyani Sen said, that the sentiment at the administration would be that padhai karne aaye ho to thoda sa wo karo, free ki padhai nahi hai. Now it is the lazy student who doesn't want to write exams. That was the caricature figure around that time. So I actually wanted to pose this question, if there's a possibility of knowing I know that I'm asking this to the right people, because I imagine both of you, and I've seen both of you straddle between the work of teaching and administration simultaneously. How do you see evaluation being reformed, or if there is a possibility of reinforcing an idea of evaluation that is not so hard on students, that does not force them to be caricatured into lazy students who do not want to write exams? Is it even fair to put this burden on teachers to push this view? But do you see a new mode of evaluation coming that is more prone to recognizing the selfhood or the subjectivity which is not divorced between, say, the home and the classroom?
Yeah. Maybe I'll just respond to this last bit, Anjika. And thanks for those reflections, which were very important, I think, for all of us. But on the last bit, I think evaluation, there has been another challenge, which also the pandemic threw in, and which I saw in the case of universities here, is also the dumbing down of evaluation. Okay? Because I think there are two kinds of universities that one is seeing, at least, and this is a classification based on this evaluation mode. I'm not going by the other classifications of universities in any way. But one is universities which have a extremely high scale of enrolled students, right? So as it is, then the conduct of exams becomes like a process, which is like literally a circus, where everything needs to be kind of moving through A, B, X, Y, Z, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? And in those kind of universities, I think issues such as can evaluations be more creative has really been a dumbing down experience, right? So you've not completed many of the things. You kept on waiting for the pandemic and some kind of a leviathan to kind of give you results. Because the way in which we made those structures is where every individual within that system, whether it is a teacher, whether it is an administrator as well, it is not teaching versus administration. But I think teachers, administrators, everyone becomes like a cog in a very, very large wheel whose pace nobody can control. Okay, And for all of those kind of systems, the pandemic has literally thrown a big spanner, right? And there, I think creativity would only mean perhaps going back and thinking about how to make these systems more manageable at a person level, where one understands students as persons, teachers as persons, bring them down. And that's what I would feel decentralization, manageability, breaking down would actually mean. Okay, and perhaps revisiting the system from that point of view. For a university like mine, which is at a much smaller scale, things have been relatively easier, I would say. Okay? In fact, some of the best teaching experiences, Vanshika, that I've had have been in the smaller classes and where one knew students previously. And their learning has been impacted, but in fact, the evaluation, I would say, was not impacted at all. Students made and were able to engage with readings. They brought into presentations. They participated in so many class discussions. Even never felt bad at all or in any way compromising the, the standards of evaluation. And yet students being with you the whole way through. And that is because you had the flexibility. You had a relatively smaller number of students. But I don't think those degrees of freedom were available to all.
Great. There are a number of comments that are coming in slowly on Facebook. And these are questions about how is evaluation for oneself? Is it for teachers? Is it for students? How do we think about mixed learning groups and so on? And I think we should return to these questions subsequently. And I promise everyone who's watching this that, of course, this is going to stay online. So I'm sure a lot more people will watch it asynchronously. But thank you, Amita, and thank you, Kalyani. The conversation has actually triggered a number of things that have been kind of freely floating around and needed to be articulated crisply. And I think in some ways, having this time frame really helped. A set of issues have at least been crisply articulated. And I'm sure we will come back to this very soon after Dodin is over. And this is something that we do anyways at Dodin regularly, that we start off some things, new insights come in, and then we pick them up within the next week and have new conversations. So we will do that. Vanshika, you're saying that there is one quick comment in Zoom. This is from Mukta. I want to read Mukta's comment. I don't think that she's actually asking for a response. She says that as a parent, I have struggled with my acceptance of the transactional nature of teaching. It took a lot of effort to stand up for my own children when they struggle with new realities. So the change really has to come from within the educational system. The demands are not likely to come from parents who do not know better and students who are at the receiving end. And I think that essentially the point here is that at least at the level of high school, all the way up to high school, the power that the school has over parents and teachers is just too much for anyone to tie and even challenge that and question that. So the demand is not likely to come from there. But again, as Kalyani was saying, that the issue, I think, is how do we think with outside of these institutional framings which are already limiting our imaginations, possibly there are new directions in which we can go. Amita and Kalyani, if you want to make one quick closing comment, we'll do that and then close it.
I wanted to thank everybody, and I wanted to be part of the conversation if it continues, which I think would be wonderful. It should. I also wanted to just again emphasize that notion of connections and relationships. So it's, along with relationships between people, relationships between disciplines and relationships between spheres of inquiry have also been, partitioned off including in universities, which started with the aspiration of breaking those binaries and bridging those boundaries. So I was just thinking when you were talking about evaluation, that in my field of practice, where one is looking at learning as a vehicle for change in complex systems, and that whole issue of emergent learning, of dealing with what is emerging from the learning process. So that's a place where there's a very rich conversation happening on how one can track and measure and feed learning back into the system. So I was just thinking, we need a conversation on evaluation that brings these two worlds together, and brings like the people who are here now and many others together. It is building those connections and those relationships that will help us to reimagine some of these things, I think, in both our worlds, in all our worlds.
Thank you, Pilani. Amita, do you want to?
So this time, as a person within the system, is also a time when the national education policy has been introduced.
Mm-hmm.
And the national education policy, while it talks, I mean, the term interdisciplinarity is there, like spread all over that policy.
Yeah.
On the other hand, it is a policy which kind of deepens many of the disjuncts, some of which we already discussed in these conversations. But there are many others which we have not touched in this brief conversation. It actually deepens some of those disjuncts completely. And I think the term relationality, which Kalyani has brought up, I think it is with that lens perhaps that one needs to also begin to read policies such as these, engage, because I see the policy in some ways as also outlining the future of higher education in the country.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, therefore, how does one bring in these kind of imaginations into that engagement, perhaps would be critical. So for me, this conversation has opened up a new line. There are no answers here. But I think these articulations, firstly, and beginning these articulations is critical, I think, for deepening the engagement.
Great. Thank you very much, Amita. Vanshika, do you want to take over at this point?
Thank you, Anant. Thanks, everyone.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you for this wonderful session. I'd just like to inform everyone that we'll be meeting next at 12:45 p.m. The session is Crisis and Amnesia. It's a session that will have Tashi Chodab and Saransh Sugand in conversation.
Vanshika, don't we have a session on data just now?
I'm sorry.
Data, no? We have a session on data. I think there's a gap in the schedule that's with you. Awesome. We have Harsha and Srinivas Kodali within the next 5 minutes.
Oh, okay, then we meet in the next 5 minutes for a session on data. So we hope that we'll see everyone there as well.
Yeah,
and a quick question. Is it the same Zoom link for Harsha and Srinivas?
No. This is a separate link. We'll send you the link in a minute.
Thanks, everyone.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.
Bye, Kalyani. Nice meeting you virtually.
Lovely.
Bye, everyone.
See you.